Good evening. My name is Dr. Tiffany Smith, and I am here to share this evening with NCWIT C4C about my STEM journey thus far. So this PowerPoint presentation will walk through my experience with STEM education from each academic level of my life. So starting with K-12 and actually the lack thereof of STEM education, where I still eventually end up going to A&T and pursuing a North Carolina A&T, excuse me, and pursuing a Bachelor's of Science in Computer Engineering. I continued my education at the PhD level by going to University of Florida and I received a PhD in human-centered computing. And now currently I am a professor at Lincoln University of Pennsylvania, where I teach computer science. And so starting first with K-8, so I was born and raised in Richmond, Virginia. I am the youngest of three. That's me on the right with my sister, my older sister, and my brother's actually in the middle between us two in ages. And so I first knew I wanted to enter STEM when we got our first home computer, which was this same model, except for we had the purple interchangeable faceplate. And so at that point, I thought STEM engineering computers, I thought that was just me hooking up the cords to make sure the computer was working. I knew nothing about programming, nothing about the ins and out, but I was like, since I put this together, which ideally is a technician, I'm going into engineering. And so by the seventh grade, it was already decided I was going to be a computer engineer. And so at that point, I was like, oh, I'm going to MIT because that's the best school for engineering. At the same time, I excelled extremely in all languages, but I had a knack for math and science. So I loved puzzles growing up. I loved the logic aspect. And ideally, that is why I was successful in my degree programs, because of having that mindset. But early on, I was labeled as gifted. And so I had different opportunities presented towards me regarding special math courses and things of that nature from kindergarten up until middle school. And when I was in high school, because of my gifted nature and because of my knack for math and science, and already having decided I was going to get a degree in engineering, in my district, we have, I believe, 12 high schools, but each high school represents a different specialty center. And so my home school was a specialty center for communication, so mass communications, journalism, things of that nature. Whereas actually the neighboring high school, but location didn't matter if you were accepted to these specialty centers. But the next closest high school actually happened to be the one for engineering. So it wasn't super far from me. My cousin actually worked at the school. And so I had the choice of staying at my home school and not participating in specialty center, or going to the high school for engineering. My home school won. So it all throughout my life, I've been extremely involved in the arts. And so my home school had show choir, and none of the other high schools in the district did, in the county did. And so I saw them in eighth grade, and I was determined to be a part of show choir. And so that ultimately made my decision. And I'm grateful for it, because I did end up having that balance of having academics in a social life and being able to explore the arts. And so although even looking back on it, I don't regret my decision at all. I was supported the entire time by family and also faculty and staff. And so while I didn't stay at my home school, I of course took advanced courses. I took AP courses while I was there. While I was there, I believe my junior and senior year, I had the best high school counselor in the world. And so this is Gina Jones. She's currently actually a principal at a neighboring middle school near my home, but ever since I met her, it was instant love at first sight. She supported all of my academic decisions, as well as my brother, because he was just a year older than me, and she also encouraged me to apply to both historically Black colleges and universities and predominantly white institutions. So luckily for me, Ms. Jones, although she wasn't a STEM major, she was also an alum of an HBCU. So she was in Norfolk State. And so she was able to see, at this point, when I graduated, my brother was at an HBCU. My sister was also at HBCU. So, and because she was from an HBCU as well, she was able to support me in that way. But also she knew, because of the rigor and how I excelled, that I shouldn't also discount these other schools, but she supported my decision either way. And so I was able to graduate second in my class. And after going on a college tour, I realized my HBCU of choice was the number one producers of African-American engineers. So once I realized that, it was a no-brainer, and that's why my decision was set on A&T. Now, because I did not go to that engineering center, we actually didn't have any that I'm aware of computer science courses at my high school at that time. I took like a Photoshop class, but nothing to do with programming, basically. I did participate in a summer robotics camp, but everything else, basically when I got to A&T, was brand new. So completely brand new to programming until I went to college. But these days, a lot of things have changed. So I graduated in 2009 from high school, but now there is so much emphasis on getting students, minority students and just students overall into STEM early on. And so these are just a few online websites that will allow students at any level, especially Scratch, it really is catered towards that K through five level up to middle school to get students introduced at least to the concepts of programming, even if they're not picking up a specific language. And so Scratch shows some block-based programming so they can understand the concepts before having to pinpoint the specifics tied to any language. Code Academy is also great. That's probably my favorite at my age now and what I'll tell others to use. It gives a lot of step-by-steps, a lot of free classes, and exercises that allow you to practice different languages and other computer science skills. Hour of Code is a part of code.org. Hour of Code is what they do. I would say it's annually, maybe in December, but basically it's a time where they want everyone K-12 to participate in some kind of coding exercise for an hour. So that's the thought behind Hour of Code. But code.org, like Code Academy, has also step-by-step guides and even lesson plans for teachers at various age level, grade levels. So K through 12, I believe they cover the whole gamut, and they have these lesson plans prepared, ways for you to introduce programming or computer science concepts into existing classes. Khan Academy is a little more, it's not coding specific, but they do offer their own set of courses. Some are free, and so you can find programming courses on Khan Academy. I don't believe it's geared towards younger students, so maybe not K through eight, but I think it will be more so for high school students. And so after high school, as I said, I went to North Carolina A&T. Greatest 4 years of my life. And so that is me in the middle and my two roommates. We were all computer engineering students and we all got on 4 years because all of us had scholarships and we weren't trying to pay beyond that. And so while I was there, we all joined the National Society of Black Engineers. And so the mission of the National Society of Black Engineers, commonly referred to as NSBE, is basically to get more Black students to be engineers, basically. That's the overall mission. And so as a part of NSBE, we were able to participate in some of their K-12 outreach programs. And so their overarching program for K-12 is called PCI, which is the Pre-College Initiative. And so that lasts throughout the entire school year. And so different NSBE chapters will put on different workshops or whatever they plan where they can just do K-12 outreach. And so it's really broad as far as what has been done and what people can do. NSBE junior chapters are specific chapters at different organizations. So they're not necessarily hosted by the collegiate level, but they're actually like in certain schools or certain community centers. And so the website for NSBE.org does have more information about the PCI and NSBE junior. There are over 170 NSBE junior chapters. So not even talking about at the collegiate level. And these chapters, like I said, they offer STEM education. They are allowed, so every year NSBE has an annual conference. These NSBE junior members are allowed to attend the annual conference, and they have their own side conference, basically, as a part of the overarching one, where they can meet some of these other students from NSBE chapters, NSBE junior chapters. While I was also at A&T, I continued to tutor. I tutored from my sophomore year till I graduated, and I also pursued research. And so one of my professors got me into an educational research. So we basically just built an app, an educational type app, but sparked my desire. I always knew I wanted to go on to graduate school, but in A&T, it was sort of finalized that I wanted to not only get my PhD, but I also wanted to be an educator. And so through research, and so you'll see my research also aligns with STEM education, and then be an educator as my final occupation. So my mom's a teacher, my sister's a teacher, my cousin's a teacher. It sort of runs in our genes. So it was a no-brainer. I knew eventually I would be tied into the education space in some way. And then also to add, being at A&T, I realized I had Black computer science women professors, but none of them had a doctorate. And so that was my motivation. I wanted my students currently now to see that we don't have to just stop at that bachelor's. We can be doctors too. We can not only be in the engineering profession, but we can also obtain the highest level of education as well. And so after those 4 years, which went by too quickly, made a pit stop at Clemson University. And then I went to University of Florida to get my PhD. A picture is missing in the background here, but it is a picture of my lab mates. And so I refer to our lab as the majority minority lab. And so my advisor, he planned it basically to introduce more minority students into STEM. And so a lot of times the issue with getting kids into STEM is that we are seeing this white male stereotype. And so by having his lab and the diversity of his lab at the University of Florida, it's now called, I think, Computing for Social Good, Dr. Juan Gilbert. Now that we are able to see each other, and then we put on our own programs so students can see the different demographic makeup of who's really in STEM. It's not a large number, but we do exist. And so at the University of Florida, I completed my PhD in human-centered computing, which is a branch under computing science. Basically, it's what the name says. And so sometimes developers or companies will create these products without really paying attention to what works for the user or the human in this case. And so with our process, we involve our human. My humans were middle school students, but we involve our human or our intended user throughout the entire development process. So as we are coming up with the different ideas, different designs, we are passing these along with the users every step of the way until we finally develop whatever we created. And so I followed my passion that I solidified at A&T of K-12 education by focusing my research on culturally relevant educational technologies. And I'll go a bit into that in the next slide. But also while I was there, I continued with K-12 outreach. And so our lab while we were at Clemson started Coded Day. And so we targeted mainly middle school. I think 1 year we did elementary as well, but middle school and elementary students, and brought them on campus for a full day. One time we did 2 days, but a full day or two workshop where they got hands-on experience with coding. And so I have another slide on that later. And then I also did some outreach with the local minority charter school. And so it was all African-American charter school K-8. So I did some of my own research there for my dissertation work, but also some other side projects there with them as well. And so I said my research was with culturally relevant technologies. And so just the background on what culturally relevant pedagogy is. And so it is the pedagogy used to teach minority students, not just African-American, but that's just what I focused on, through their cultural filters. And so these filters are previous experience, life at home. So just references that make sense. So not necessarily tied to academic, but using those outside references, bringing them into the classroom to make it easier to learn. And so this pedagogy was popularized by Gloria Ladson Billings in the 90s. And since then it has sort of evolved into various renditions of culturally relevant pedagogy. So you might hear culturally responsive pedagogy. You might hear culturally sustained pedagogy, culturally relevant teaching, but they're all sort of grounded in that same idea of using a student's culture defined by whatever their culture is, whatever their experience is in education. And so my focus was on math technologies. And so there are some existing ones. This is a screenshot of an online, what's considered a culturally situated design tool. So CSDT by Ron Eaglash and his associates. And so basically the CSDTs, what they did is they allowed students to learn different techniques or concepts using their culture. And so he covered various cultures. This is of African-American culture. There's some on Native American culture, Latin culture, I believe, and there's just a whole list of different cultures. And so with this, Cornrow Curves, which is the name of the software, it allows students to create the patterns that are seen within braiding cornrows. And so they mapped it to geometry skills, so translation, rotation. So things they know about, in the African-American community, and tying into these topics to make it make a little more sense. And so for me, my motivation behind my dissertation work was, I'm a lover of math. Math is absolutely my first love. But algebra tends to be the gatekeeper course into STEM. And so these images down here, they basically are showing, they're by NCES, so the National Center of Education and Statistics. These are a little outdated now, but at the time they were relevant when I was in my PhD process. But each of these are just highlighting different grade levels. So here we have fourth grade and eighth grade, and then this is representing students in 12th grade. And so this is showing the percentage of those that are at or above proficiency. And as you can see, the highlighted red row, is Black students. And so in all of these tables, they are severely underperforming compared to their different counterparts. So the poor African-American performance in math, coupled with the need to be deemed good in algebra in order to get into the STEM fields, along with the disconnect between academic, which is traditionally Eurocentric culture, and home cultures, which can vary, but still have some of that shared African-American experience tied in. Those were the motivational factors behind why I chose to pursue what I did for my PhD work. And so I combined culture. I end up going to pre-algebra because I learned it's hard to get into algebra if your pre-algebra foundation is shaky. And so that became my focus content-wise, combined with interface design from my discipline using some gamification and digital game-based learning. And then embodied learning, which is moving with your body and learning, making that connection, so that mind-body connection. I use that to develop Making Math Move. And so what Making Math Move is a technology that utilized the Kinect. And so that's paired with the Xbox, but they also had a separate Kinect for Windows that you can connect to a computer. And so with the Kinect, I developed an application, and I'll show some screen grabs on the next screen, but it allows students, sixth and seventh grade African-American students were my targeted demographic, but it allowed them to work through solving math problems using their body, using a Kinect, using some movement, some math, some music, to get them to make math move. And so here would be an initial first screen. And so it tells the students what they need to do, shows them the problem. So here we have 12 greater than or equal to P over 3, and then asks them to solve it. And so the way it works, the students would select, and so they're in front of the Kinect, so it's picking up their hand motions. And so they would select the 12 and it becomes highlighted. And then they have to perform the operation to solve P. And so since P is being divided by 3, the opposite operation will be multiplication. And so these gestures, which were collected during a gesture elicitation study, so students came up with these gestures that they would use for these math operations. And I'm not sure if you can see, but they look traditional to what the symbols look like. So students chose to do this for add, subtract, multiplication, and then divide to sort of represent the dots on top of the division symbol. And so by performing multiplication with their arms, it would then show that that was selected. And then students had to select the other operand involved in the equation. And so they would, of course, select 3. And so once they got to the step where it was time to solve, if they made an error before, it would give a hint specific to the type of error. So if they chose the wrong operation, it would say, what's the opposite operation of division? So you let them know that's how you're supposed to figure out how to solve it. And so once they're here, they'll use their hand again as a cursor to select the answer and then hit enter, and then it moves on to the next problem. And so that was my contribution after completing my PhD. And then I just wanna go back to Coded Day. And so like I said, we established it at Clemson, actually the year before I started at Clemson. So I was there for a year before we transitioned to University of Florida. But like I said before, it's a means to combat that stereotype of white males. Yes, they are part of engineering, but also we women, Black people, Asians, Africans, we all can make up and we're all diverse and we all can be a part, Hispanic students, everything. And so we had, I feel like a lot of people from different cultures, both men and women, who represented either undergraduate or graduate students at Coded Day. And so some of the technologies we have used, Makey is the one here. And so basically with Makey, you're able to use everyday items as conductors. And so if you can see here, this is just Play-Doh. And so by mapping it to the different functionalities on the Makey Makey pad, students were able to play Mario by pressing on these instead of using a traditional joystick. Kano, which I really like. So Kano allows you to buy a kit. The students can assemble it themselves. And then on the back, you can't see it here, but on the back is actually a touchscreen. So they are, what I thought, putting together a computer, got me interested in engineering. And so it allows them not only to connect the computer themselves, but then they're able to program. So this is a keyboard and it all comes in a compact kit. I really like dealing with those. Prior to Lego Mindstorms was a really big thing for a while, but I believe they discontinued it. And so now this is their current version. I believe it's called Storm, but it's very similar to the original Lego Mindstorms. And so it utilizes the block-based programming, which is seen with Scratch. And so not having to know all the specific syntax with Python or Java or C++, it allows them to see these words. So instead of trying to know loop, repeat. So the concepts are much, much clearer, and anybody can use this type of block-based programming. And so that brings me to my current stage. Now I am an assistant professor at Lincoln University, small campus in Pennsylvania. It is also an HBCU. I had to make sure I got back to one just because of how much my HBCU, North Carolina A&T, had an impact on me. And so it's about 2,000 students overall, so pretty small. The majority of our makeup are African and African-American students. And so mainly from the Northeastern area, there's only maybe three HBCUs, Delaware and Pennsylvania. It's not a lot. And so our students often are first generational students. Like me, they don't have that computer science background. So a lot of times also their math is a little weak. And so it's a little bit of, it prohibits them from jumping into the major exactly. But once they get in, the students, as long as you believe in them, they have a strong confidence, and a lot of them go on to do a lot of great things. So I've had students that graduated and gone to Google, IBM, and I've only been there for 4 years now. And so some of my past explorations and current explorations in this past 4 years, when I first got to Lincoln, a professor in biology invited me to work on a grant for mobile STEM education in higher ed, which makes sense because everybody has a phone attached to their hand. So mobile learning is, of course, the way to go. And so by making these apps, it reinforces what's taught in the classroom, and students can do it anytime. And so it also allows them to explore different topics deeper. And so the app that the students created was called Ashman Express. Ashman was the former name of Lincoln. And so it allowed students to apply math concepts and discipline-specific problems with content they were familiar with because it was written by current students and by current faculty. So it wasn't like a textbook that they've never seen any of this before or was reworded in a different way. They're familiar. And so it allowed multiple modes of engaging with content. So we had the tutorial mode, examples, practice, and test. And then those four modes were at different levels. So at level one, the initial stage, you could go through the tutorial, example, practice, and test. As you get more confident and as the concepts get harder, you move on to level two and so on and so forth. So it had that embedded scaffolding with linear progression, with increasing difficulty within the modes. And so just some screenshots, the students midway through was like dark modes the way. So they revamped it so that we could have a dark mode. But here you can see the tutorial and the various levels and then the example and the practice. And then this is just a screenshot of an example tied to genetics. So this was mainly done for a genetics class and also a math class, I believe statistics. And so the example part, they were given questions, but then it walked them through it before they could practice on their own. And so that was done and it was presented at ASEE, so the American Society of Engineering Education, I believe in 2021. What I'm currently working on myself as of now, hopefully I want to expand it across the department, but culturally relevant learning in higher ed. So the culturally relevant book has bit me and I don't think I'm gonna move anytime soon. But currently, culturally relevant education is predominant at the K-12 level. There's not a lot of frameworks or a lot of work being done at higher ed, which doesn't make sense because there are students of culture in the higher education level as well. And so I've started using the Kapoor Center's culturally responsive sustaining CS framework as a guideline. And so these are the six components. And so the framework not only offers a definition of what culturally responsive sustaining CS Ed is, once again, a spinoff a representation with some different takes on the original culturally relevant pedagogy applied to the computing space, of course. And so these are six of the components that are part of the framework in the definition. And so basically these are the components they feel should be included if culturally relevant information is being introduced in the CS settings. And so they have these as well as suggestions that will make it easier for K-12 educators to introduce into the classroom. And so I was able to develop two modules last semester for my students, and I'm currently in the process of applying for a grant through Mozilla, like Mozilla Firefox, to bring this on a larger scale across more of my other classes. And so hopefully that'll go well and I'll get the grant money for that. I also have two students currently working on VR for STEM education. I did let them pick whatever they wanted, but both stayed true to my love of STEM education. And so they're each working on their own separate project, one for math. And so one of my students, she's working on teaching circle geometry. So she's creating a gamified VR tool to help high school students explore and master those circle geometry concepts in the form of a racing game. And then my other student, she is interested in how we can use VR to help further education on less studied diseases that mainly affect Black and Brown communities. So her focus right now is on sickle cell. So she's working to develop a way in which we can look at chromosomes, highlight them, manipulate them to see what impact they would have on the disease and treatment and things of that nature. And so what does my future hold? This summer, I was awarded money from Google and I'm using it to do a virtual bridge program. And so it's called the Pounce 2 program. We're the Lincoln Lions, hence the Pounce. And so Pounce stands for preparing our undergraduates new to computing in college environments. And so, as I said, often our students at Lincoln have a weaker math foundation. And because of their weak foundation, they're placed in classes that don't allow them to start their actual CS courses immediately. And so oftentimes students are held back even a year or two because they don't meet that college algebra math upon entry. And also, like me, no computer science background. And so what this virtual summer program will do will not only serve as a remedial math course to get them to where they need to be. Lincoln does allow them to take the placement test 3 times before fall semester, but also it'll get them just an introduction on computer science programming concepts, so it's not a shock when they get to campus in August, and also just some acclimation material. So my current students will serve as mentors during the summer. And then as well, I want to have a year-long freshman cohort with these students who are a part of the summer bridge program. Because a lot of times you can do a bridge program and then the students just get lost afterwards. But I think by having that near peer mentoring with my current students, and then as well as just me as their own outside advisor. So having different programs and different sessions to guide them along to the way to structure their freshman year so they can make the best out of the rest of their time at Lincoln. So as I said, it'd be led by myself and then current CS students. And so it'll utilize some of the things that have been seen in retaining and broadening minority participation. So looking at the social cognitive career theory, I mentioned near peer mentoring, so having people that are close to their age. And it doesn't hurt that I'm also young, so I'm not super far removed from the undergraduate experience. And then of course, I'm using that culturally relevant pedagogy and then intersectionality, especially for my women. I'm only the only woman on computer science department and the only Black woman. And so I think that intersectionality, it makes me a lot more relatable to my students because I am the only African-American professor there. And so I wanna hone in on that to let them know that I'm here, I see them, and I know people that look like us and they can benefit from that as well. And then lastly, I want to use that block-based programming I mentioned with Scratch and with the Legos for primary education and create some type of culturally relevant block-based programming system. And so what it will do, it will use these easy, programming tools that does exist, but I feel like if we wait too late to get students introduced into STEM, so waiting until high school, sometimes we can reach them a little bit earlier, at least pique their interest so they know what to look out for when they get to middle school. So finding a way to create something for those like fourth or fifth grade students, so that when they get to starting exploratory courses in middle school, they can think about, am I interested in computing? And so far K through five, block-based programming has worked. And so I wanna build on that to hopefully create something culturally relevant. There are tools, of course, out there for K through five, but I think it will help for our minority students to see themselves or see people that look like them, role models, and see what has already been done in the tech space and how they can desire to grow up to do something like that. And so I hope you all gain some knowledge from this presentation. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. Like I said, I'm at Lincoln University. And so my email is tsmith1@lincoln.edu, or you can reach out to those in charge of the program and they will have a way to contact me. Thank you and enjoy your evening. My work. While I use the Connect for my work, like I said, it discontinued shortly thereafter. And so I still like the thought of using your body to learn. Embodied cognition is one of the theories that I included in my work. And so VR was the next logical step for me to transition into. And so I have two undergraduate students, one continuing my passion of K-12 math education. So she's looking at creating, I want to say it's like a race car styled game for to help students learn circle geometry particularly. I let them pick their own topics. And then I have another student who's investigating how to allow students to manipulate different chromosomes to explore right now the sickle cell disease. And so I let them get free rein. I am teaching them some of the structure I learned as far as human centered computing while I was in grad school. But I do want them to explore topics that hit home for them or some things they are very interested in talking about. And so as far as the future, what that holds for me at Lincoln, continue to work with those two students as they work on their projects. And then this upcoming summer, I was recently awarded a grant, a $60,000 grant from Google. And so I'm gonna host a virtual summer bridge program called the Pounce program, and standing for preparing our undergrads new to computing and college environments. Lincoln, the mascots, the lion, excuse me. So that's Pounce. What I found in my 4 years at Lincoln, my students from the New York, Pennsylvania region, very underprepared when it comes to math. And so often because they come in placing so low, they aren't able to graduate in 4 years. I don't see that with my international students. There's a very heavy African presence, students, but my New York, my PA, those students, they want to pursue computer science, but their math is so low, it takes them 2 years to get to the math they need to start their computer science classes. And so this summer, they have three chances to retake their math placement. And so for 6 weeks, I'm gonna work with introducing them to computer science concepts, but mainly doing a remedial math tutorial so that these students can at least start where they need to, so they can hopefully graduate closer to 4 years than 6 or 7 years. And then after the summer, having a mentoring program for these freshmen using myself and then some of my students at various phases. So sophomores, juniors, and seniors, just so they can get acclimated to not only college, but also computer science, what that looks like, and also introduce them to speakers who they might not be familiar with, show them Black people that exist in tech, because they might not, I didn't know any engineers going into ANT. And so just having them familiar, and so they can see that they can succeed and what life could potentially look like after their 4 years at Lincoln. One last slide, I think. Can't find my mouse. So I'm also interested in, I mentioned the block-based programming with Scratch, but I'm also interested in creating something that will allow that culturally relevant twist. And once again, K-5 is where my heart lies. So for primary education, so getting these students even younger, because the thing is with CS, we have that pipeline, where's the leaky pipeline, where students fall through. And I think trying to get students interested in 11th, 12th grade may be a little bit too late. And so by hitting them early, not worried about specific languages, but using colorful blocks, words they understand, but also once again, having that cultural piece so they can see themselves in computing and not think that it's for somebody other than them. A lot of times students don't like math. I hate math, it's not for me. But often they're not taught to see it in a light where, hey, this makes sense, where people like me can do math. These are math pioneers and things of that nature. And so I'm working on grants to have this project come to fruition so I can focus on those students in primary education so they can also CCS before it's too late. And with that, I'll stop and take any questions that anyone may have.
Thank you so much, Dr. Smith. We are going to monitor the Q&A chat, but I do have a couple of questions that we can talk about. So you talked about a lot, which was amazing. I appreciate you sharing the journey and also learning that you're from Virginia too, as well. So that's amazing. But tell us a little bit about being young, a young person in tech, and handling like social expectations, whatever you think educators should know. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
So I'm currently the youngest person. Our department is very small. The youngest person, the only woman, and the only Black person on the faculty for computer science. And so, even my students, when I first came in, I just told them I went to school because I also did not have to pay for my PhD. And so I come out the gate, y'all don't have to go to grad school, but also we can go for free. I'm telling you, there's opportunities and things like that. And so getting to Lincoln, so because I was in school for all of my life, and that being my first job, it was a little cold. I will say going in because it was the all boys team. A lot of things played into the fact I was a woman, I believe, and because I was younger, very fresh. My colleagues are at least 20, 30 years older than me. And so I think they were a little hesitant to having new ideas and a new person. And some of my friends have also experienced it because I had friends leave A&T and go straight into work. And so of course they're gonna be the youngest ones. I'm grateful to have, I wish my picture would have showed up from my lab mates, but because of the culture that my advisor created, I'm still friends with those people. And so I'm still able to talk to those people from A&T and Florida. And so we'll talk about the different experiences we have. For them, it's quite different because they're in industry, but I also find some same battles just being young and Black and in tech. I was grateful to have and lucky to have the cohort I had at Florida, but I go to some conferences and it's the Black women in CS community is so small. We have a group me where most of us are in it. It's not that many of us. And so just having that network and that community, it does exist. I tell my students about it, try to get them to go to conferences that are catered towards Black people like NSBE so they can see Lincoln is tiny, tiny. It's 2,000 students. But we exist, we're out there, and there's people that you can lean on. Go into tech, don't be afraid. And so even having my friends who are in industry and in academia, just talking to my students through Zoom so they can see there is life outside of Lincoln. We exist outside of Lincoln and it's gonna be fine.
And Dr. Smith, you hit on some of the key components that also counselors and when individuals attend the C4C trainings and we talk about the statistics and we hit on the diversity and we look at how we're trying to broaden that scope in CS to all, especially to our younger ladies and to minorities, and finding those pieces such as you, Dr. Smith, of saying, hey, whether it's a podcast or something that we look at, we reference in our resource guide, Tecnolochicas, young ladies of Latin descent that are coding and doing the computer science. So you learning that there is an avenue for students that look just like them or people that look like them as well, that this, you too belong in this field. That's what's ringing in my head right now. And so I get so excited because the possibility, or the word that I use a lot in the trainings, access. Mm-hmm. This is total access to that. One of the questions that we have from Ms. Ashley Taylor says, do you have suggestions on how we can show CSDT to our students? or how at the high school and middle school levels, we can use these resources to engage our students in computer science.
So I haven't, outside of like doing my research for my my dissertation document, I played around with CSCTs. I believe the link is put in the chat. I believe the website has it broken down by not only by cultures, but also then by the topic. So like I said, the cornrow curves is for geometry, but then they also have one on the Cartesian plane. And so just looking to see what they have already out there that exists, and then just incorporating that CSDT into the lesson. I'm not sure if there's any, I haven't been on the site in a while, if there's any lesson plans already out there for how to incorporate it or not. But I definitely, going back to code.org, they definitely have lesson plans for every grade level, K-12, which I believe are free. I know I signed up for a teacher account myself, and they have everything laid out for you. So.
They're pretty amazing. Yeah. Awesome. So spiraling back to part of what you were talking about in your journey, again, can you hit just a little bit about like some suggestions that you have for others, whether it be for others finding their community or for educators helping students find that community? I know you mentioned a lot about different opportunities. You have an opportunity coming up that I'm so excited to connect you with. Being a secondary principal, I need to know how I can get students there and exposed. So can you talk a little bit more about how do we connect those dots to find that community?
It's a little hard. So my sister's a math teacher, high school in Columbia, South Carolina. And so thankfully her school is set up so they have, I can't think of actually what their program is called, but she dragged me and my friends on their board for their computing, some computing board for something that they have. I think the hard thing about it is, and while I'm always quick to jump at opportunities like this, a lot of times because our community, just speaking for Black women in computing, is so small, sometimes there's slight burnout on our end because y'all always calling me to do this, always. Now for me, I'm gonna say yes every time, just because even at Lincoln, though the school is small, even while I was at Auntie, the number of women was far lower than the men. But my women are always my best students, and I'll tell the guys any day. So any encouragement I can give, whether it's me personally coming to speak or having my students speak, I know I'm willing to do that. Like I said, our community is very small. I'm trying to think, maybe, like I said, reaching out to like NSBE. I know on the NSBE Junior page, seeing what chapters already exist. Like I said, a lot of times, especially if there is a historically Black college near you and they have that engineering program, NSBE is bound to exist, or somebody is bound to know. And then even in larger cities, so I'm currently in Richmond, but I live in Delaware. And so Philly has a NSBE professional Philly mm-hmm. chapter. And so they do their own outreach with K-12. And so even if you can't find a NSBE junior chapter, finding a NSBE professional chapter, and I know they can reach out. I know there's various robotics leagues. I think it's called mm-hmm. First Robotics or Lego, First Lego. I don't know. I keep my counselor, like I said, she's a middle school student. So I know I personally reach back out to those people who have helped me along the way, the charter school in Florida, things of that nature. But I sort of wish more people would do the same, and I can't push it on people. But if you find any of us, we are more than willing to help. And as I come across any resources that I can think of to bridge the gap, I definitely will send it.
Gotcha. That's awesome. Now let's go back to somebody that you mentioned during your presentation. You had a very supportive school counselor, mm-hmm. from what I understand. So what advice do you have, if we have any counselors that are listening, to engage their students in STEM and computer science?
Now, Ms. Jones, what was Ms. Jones? Ms. Jones was not in STEM, I don't believe at all.
right.
And when I say she was supportive, and also just to the counselors, even if you don't think you're making a difference, trust me, you are. I still talk about Miss Jones to this day, and it's been 15 wow. years. Like, she still has my heart. She's a part of my family, my mom. They see each other. They're going to awesome. Take a picture and send it to me. So even if, like, on your low days, if you think you're not making a difference, trust me, you are. Because I'm sure there are plenty Miss Joneses on this call right now. So for me, I was, like I said, I knew in seventh grade, so I was very headstrong. So for her, it was just, whatever you want to do, I'm going to support you. She did encourage me to look at other schools because I was so MIT, Columbia, that was it. And it actually took for a friend of mine to say, come with me on this HBCU tour. I was like, I'm going to Columbia. When I went down there and found out that A&T is the number one producer of Black engineers, that's all I needed to hear. And so they talked to me. I did graduate second in my class. And at that time, they had a scholarship for valedictorians and salutatorians. I'm the youngest of three. We're stair-step kids. So all three of us were in college at the same time. So I was like a full ride to a place that produces the most engineers. I was sold. And so I didn't even turn in my Columbia application because that one trip changed my life. So if you can encourage students to go on these tours, I know some schools, I think, still have some like virtual type of college tours. I know it's pretty heavy during COVID. And then specifically for HBCUs, there's a common application that allows you to pay $20, I believe, to access maybe 20. Like, it's a lot of HBCUs at one time. And so that one fee pays for the application for that. But any kind of school tours, any STEM opportunities, like I said, I should have went to the engineering school, I know, but that balance was huge for me because I was the brainiac and I was labor gifted and I needed that academic break. And so I definitely do tell my students, you don't have to be smart, smart, smart all the time. Make sure you have that balance because that burnout is real. And so for me, when I was doing my PhD, Zumba became my crutch because I was like, I got to focus on these dance moves. I can't focus on school. And so having that balance worked wonders for me. And I still go to Zumba twice a week now.
I need to do Zumba a little bit, but I'm trying to work out work-life balance still. So still a work in progress, but it's good to hear that you have that balance as well. Hitting on some additional from your counselor and your career getting to where you are now, can you speak more about like the programs and scholarships you received for school and where did you find them? Because I think you mentioned that you went like for free. So can you talk a little bit about like what it was or how that kind of fell, how the stars aligned for that?
So like I said, we stair-step kids. So my sister's 3 years older, my brother's a year older. And so my sister had to go first and pave the way as far as FAFSA scholarships and all the things like that. Yeah. Even before I found out that I got a full ride to A&T, I still, of course, applied. I had like a free period in high school and I plucked Miss Jones. I sat in her office and filled out scholarship applications. The counselor knew me. I just sat there. I was like, my mama had three kids. Somebody going to school for free. And what I tend to do, so I went to A&T for free. And then with grad school, my advisor, because of his focus on diversity students, he received grants to fund students. Mainly NSF provided the money, but then also on my own, I also applied for, NSF has a graduate research fellowship program. And so I just proposed my research work that I was gonna do and they funded me also for 3 years. And so now currently for the last 2 years, I've started a scholarship spreadsheet for my students. And so any internships, opportunities I come across or scholarships, I link it and update it myself. And my mother also plugs me to people. And so I started infant stage of starting one for high school students as well. I know there's one and I'll type it in the chat, the scholarship plug. I found them on Instagram, but this woman who puts together the list, she updates it a lot more frequently than I do. And it's mainly high school students. I'm partners or I'm groups on Facebook, scholarship pages on Facebook. So any opportunity I see, I pass it to the people I know. My sister, because like I said, she's a high school teacher. And so anything I come across, I try to share it. I tell my students, this money is out there. Take it, please. Like they want to give it away. Please apply for anything. Even if you don't want to do it, as far as like internships goes, you'll learn that you don't like it, but at least you had the experience and you can say that you tried.
Yep. And as a from the classroom to counselor before I did counseling, I did the, as I say, the hardcore counseling for about 8 years, being in that office, having those kids come, you know, looking at scholarships, making sure that essay was appropriate, making sure we're looking at all of the things that cross the T's and dot the I's. It is very important. I remember actually going to classrooms and saying, hey, I knew my students so well that I knew what school they may have wanted to go to or what interest they may have had. I knew the students who didn't have an interest, so to expose them to. So it sounds like not much has changed. When I go by my school counseling office at my school, I can see some kids. This is scholarship season. They kind of hang around and I'm like, if they're here, you know, talk to them, get those scholarships in, you know, because they're running in. And so thank you for that scholarship plug too, because I'm going to definitely search. I wrote that down while you were talking. So thank you. Thank you. We have a question from the audience. It says that the work that you have done and that of your grad students represents a very specific application, very specific applications. I would have expected the work to be much broader. I appreciate that these projects are not so overwhelming to solve a giant problem. It is significant to me as I have been reluctant to tackle a doctorate in this field because of the issues seem so heavy and to make a dent in. Can you speak to my misunderstanding about expectations for the scope and doctoral projects in this field? Okay. Good question. Thank you for that question. Good question.
They'll tell you a good dissertation is a finished one. So
I'm working on mine.
And I think the problem is, and my advisor had to get on all of us, we try to solve the world's problems. He's like, solve this one problem, get your PhD, and go solve some more. But it's all about solving one. And so, yeah, so my work, it was pre-algebra for sixth and seventh grade African-American students. Now, all students used it who signed up to use it, but it was focusing on how the culture impacted those students. And even so within that scope, there were, it was 9 common areas of pre-algebra misconceptions. I only tackled one. Like you narrow it down as much as you can, because if you try to solve such a huge problem, you're gonna be in that PhD for the rest of your life. And so, so it's not, it is not trying to solve the world's problems at one time. You can tackle more afterwards, but the more narrow and defined your scope can be, and then even the more novel the approach can be, the better. So narrow is definitely way, way better than broad.
and I love that you had one of the one of your pictures show like a cone and how you put things in and then you funneled into, and that anyone that's in doctoral work will understand. And like me, I'm on the home stretch, and I'm saying that because I'm trying my best to finish strong. But that was part of the thing going in. I was like, this is so broad, and like I would talk about things so broad, and so my advisor would tell me all the time, what are you specifically going to do about chronic absenteeism? What are you specifically going to do about that? We know it's a problem, but what piece of that? So, and just remembering, and Dr. Smith, please correct me if I'm wrong, when you narrow it down, you're absolutely adding to the research in that field, your nugget as to this bigger piece. And that's what I have learned over my years studying. I'm studying at ODU right now, learning that it doesn't have to be, you know, save the world, but that little piece helps to create the, you know, and I can say, yes, I contributed to that problem. Yep. And I have sound research. So it's amazing I can have that conversation. So I'm excited that I'm hosting tonight. So one final question that we want to go over before we kind of wrap up. What are you excited about in the future of technology, Dr. Smith? What should we as educators be aware of to continue to engage and encourage all students?
So AI is my fear, actually, and it shouldn't be. People's like, you're in computer science, you don't like AI. I love AI for the potential that it has. So one of my friends, her work was using conversational agents. And so I'm not sure if you all have heard about ChatGPT at this point. But it gives like responses off of very few keywords. And so the fact that it's able to pull from big bodies of knowledge is amazing. However, plagiarism. I had a student, bless her heart, she's working on a paper with me, and she was like, is it okay if I use ChatGPT? I said, ma'am, she was like, it's not plagiarism because I didn't take from anybody else. I said, but you weren't the author of these words. Mm-hmm. And so that's my fear with AI right now, where it can go because of how I don't call it smart because it's not smart, but how powerful it is because it's combining all these things. But also the potential of AI is also amazing if it's used for good. AI is so broad and so expansive. I'm scared to get into it myself. but I am hopeful that people can not use it for good. I mean, excuse me, not use it for evil, but use it for good. And right. It will be amazing at how many problems it can solve just as these algorithms grow and grow and they become more powerful. So.
Very good point. And also in our C4C training, we do cover a little bit of that too. So we are on target tonight. and I just love it. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is all of the questions that we can take today because we do have a timed program. But we hope that you will join us for our next two webinars in February or view past webinars by going to the link at the end of the chat. Finally, we want you to look out for a survey in your email within the next few days. Responding to the survey will enter you in a drawing for $100 Amazon gift card. Who doesn't like Amazon, right? So $100 Amazon gift card and a resource kit from C4C. We thank you for your responses and joining us today. And we hope that we will see you at our next webinar in March and April. Thank you so much, Dr. Smith. I have a friend and colleague now. I'm going to find you and connect with you as well. Everybody, you have a great night. Have a great week. Peace and joy.
Bye-bye, everyone.